We are going to go together this morning to God's Word. And if you'll stand with me for the reading of God's Word. God laid a message upon my heart that I believe is an important one. And if we've got people in this room that are at pretty much every stage of their walk with God. There's at least one of you in the room that's been serving God for over 50 years. And there are others of you that your walk with God may have begun 50 days ago. But here is a certain reality, and that is this. At some point in every one of our walk with God, there will be moments when we fail, when we fall, when we come up short. And that can be a really critical juncture for us. Because for some people, they serve God until they fall, until they make a mistake, particularly a public or messy mistake. And then that's the end of their story, their walk with God. But Scripture is full of examples of people who failed God miserably and yet went on then to do great things for Him. And so today I want to give you a message of not only hope, but I also want to give you some practical instruction on how you can handle the fall in your life. Amen. We're going to look at John chapter 21 and verses 15 to 17. The Bible says, "So when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?' He said to him, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' He said to him, 'Feed my lambs.' He said to him again a second time, 'Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?' He said to him, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' He said to him, 'Tend my sheep.' He said to him the third time, 'Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?' Peter was grieved because he had said to him the third time, 'Do you love me?' And he said to him, 'Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you.' Jesus said to him, 'Feed my sheep.'" And today I want to talk to you on the subject, the restoration of the fallen. The restoration of the fallen. Let's look to the Lord right now and ask that God would help us. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray right now that you would speak into our hearts. And God, that you would come into this service right now, Lord, to do a special work, Lord, to achieve a special purpose in our lives. I pray that you would help us, oh God, right now, to hear and to receive your word, Lord, I pray. And God, for the work that needs to be done in lives and hearts right now, Father, that you would have your way, Lord, speak to us, God, and prepare us to respond to your word, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated here today. Now, the dialogue that we just read between Jesus and Simon Peter might seem a little strange. There is an odd repetitiveness to it, a kind of cadence, and the end of the result of the conversation isn't immediately obvious as you look at it. It seems like there was a kind of a question and answer period, and both the questions, the answers, and then the response from Jesus seemed pretty much the same. But to understand what's going on here and the significance of this passage, it requires us to backtrack a few weeks in the chronology of Scripture to understand what is going on. When we think about the betrayer of Jesus, it is, of course, Judas who dominates our attention when it comes to betrayal. When someone is called a Judas, it is because that name is associated with betrayal, with stabbing someone in the back. But there are really not a whole lot of lessons that we can learn from Judas. His failures are broad and obvious, and there is no restoration story with Judas that would allow us to see how he might have recovered from such a failure in his own life. But there was a more subtle betrayal that happened that night in Gethsemane, and that, of course, was that of Simon Peter. The setup for Peter's betrayal actually happens in a more obvious way and on a larger stage than what Judas' betrayal did. Jesus warned his disciples, and we see on a number of occasions that Jesus did attempt to do this. He tried to let them in on the secret of what was about to come and what they were going to have to face. And so at this point we see that that Jesus is trying once again to warn them that things are going to get bad and dark on this night, and letting them know that there's going to be a positive outcome. He's not only letting them know about the awful events of Calvary that are upcoming, but also also the hope of the resurrection. He tries to communicate it all to them. And in Matthew 26 and 31, the Bible says, Jesus said to them, "All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee." Then Peter answered and said to him, "Even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble." Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." Peter said to him, "Even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. You see, the interesting thing is that if you read the various gospel accounts of what happens that we call the Last Supper, which is the final moment when Judas is a part of the 12, the reality is that Jesus is discreet enough in what he communicates to Judas that Judas gets up and slips out to go and to fulfill the betrayal of Jesus, and the disciples don't really know what's going on. In fact, the majority of them thought that he had gone out to buy some additional supplies because he was the secretary treasurer of the group, and so they really had no idea what Judas was up to. But of course, Peter, the setup for his failure is loud and public, and that is because Peter made his brag loudly and publicly. The words that he spoke in this instance when Jesus warns him of what is to come, they're foolish on a number of levels. First of all, he contradicts Jesus. Jesus says this is going to happen, and Peter says, "No, it's not." Now, it's never really smart when you start arguing with God and telling God that he's wrong. Right. Just as a general matter of principle. He does this very publicly. It's not a discreet thing where he pulls Jesus aside and says, "Jesus, are you sure about what you're saying?" But instead, he publicly rebukes Jesus and confronts him. He speaks foolishly, and he does it multiple times. He doesn't just contradict Jesus the first time when Jesus follows up and says, "No, this is going to happen." And in fact, here's more detail. Peter still says, no, I'm not going to deny you. Secondly, he singles himself out and boasts about his superiority. He throws the rest of them under the bus and says, "Well, Lord, no, I, even if all were made to stumble, I would never stumble." He's boasting about his superiority. And if you recall, leading up to this night, one of the big problems that they had was this argument over who was the greatest amongst them. And so we see that Peter is continuing on with this same kind of challenge, in that it seems like he's learned nothing from the lesson where Jesus gets down and washes their feet. The disciples are bragging about which one of them is the greatest in God's kingdom. Meanwhile, the truly greatest among them is down girding himself like a servant and washing their feet. And that was a little bit embarrassing for Peter, because of course Peter again there was the one to blurt out and try to stop Jesus from humbling himself. But it's clear that the lesson that Jesus taught hadn't entirely settled in, because Peter was still singling himself out and saying, no, I'm better than the rest of these guys. And that leads us to the third problem here, and that is that he is debasing his fellow disciples in order to exalt himself. The Bible teaches us a lot in the New Testament how that we are to prefer one another, that we're not to try to promote ourselves over others, but rather to try to promote others. And we see Peter doing the exact opposite of this. He's making a loud, boastful, braggadocious statement. It's a classic example of the truth of this proverb that pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And unfortunately, Peter was setting himself up for a major fall. Now, probably few of us here today have actively conspired with the enemies of Christ to betray him and to set him up to be arrested. Unlikely. But probably many of us can relate to moments of boastfulness, ego, pride, that are followed by failure, where we don't live up to our spoken word, to our public persona. See, it's one thing to fall. It's a whole other thing fall publicly. You've probably tripped in private before, and when you trip in private, you might look around and make sure that no one saw, and then, you'll dust yourself off and you'll get back to doing life. Yeah. not a big deal, because many times when we fall, the thing we're most concerned about is who saw us. I've tripped over cords a number of times in my life. So far, I've survived it every time. But the one that sticks out in my mind is that when I was in my late teens, somewhere around 17, 18, 19 years old, probably 18-ish, and so I was with my family, and we had traveled to a large church in Las Vegas, Nevada, and I was on the drums while my parents sang, and my parents had asked me to come to the pulpit to sing or to testify. I can't remember exactly what, but what I can remember very clearly is that somewhere in between the drums and the pulpit on that large platform, there was a cable that reached out and grabbed me and tripped me, and so I fell forward, not quite on my face, but catching myself on my hands, full pitch forward, and my immediate concern was for all the teenage girls that were in the because they clearly were not getting the full Dustin Abbott experience. As far as damage done to me physically, zero. Damage done to my pride, well, here I am, nearly 45 years old, and I still remember. That's the problem with a public fall, a public failure. I want you to note that at this moment, Peter is trying to be a leader in his own kind of sense. He's trying to push him to the forefront of the group and say, Lord, I'm going to lead in the right direction. I'm going to be the guy. I'm going to be the spokesperson by force of will. He is kind of pushing himself into that place, but he is about to discover how worthless his bluster and his ego actually was when the moment matters. Because things start to go downhill fast from this moment. First of all, he fell asleep when he was supposed to be praying. He slashed out with his sword when they came to arrest Jesus and accomplished nothing other than giving Jesus the responsibility of performing a final miracle to heal the ear that he severed from a servant's head. He didn't get a soldier, he got a servant. When given the opportunity to run and to abandon Jesus to preserve himself, he ran without hesitation. And then things go from bad to worse. For Jesus is now arrested and is already being abused and tortured and falsely accused. And he stands alone against all of his enemies. And Peter came in from a distance and got in the nearby vicinity in the courtyard of where Jesus was being tried. But even then, when he's given an opportunity to stand for Jesus and identify with him, we see that Peter's failure becomes increasingly public at this point. Matthew records in Matthew 26 and 69, now Peter sat outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him saying, you also were with Jesus of Galilee. But he denied it before them all, saying, I do not know what you are saying. And when he had gone out to the gateway, another girl saw him and said to those who were there, this fellow also was with Jesus of Nazareth. But again, he denied with the oath, I do not know the man. And a little while later, those who stood by came up and said to Peter, surely you are also one of them, for your speech betrays you. Then he began to curse and swear, saying, I do not know the man. Immediately, a rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the word of Jesus who said to him, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. So he went out and wept bitterly. We can basically watch Peter's fall in real time. It starts with a denial of Jesus in order to protect himself. And by the end, he is literally cursing and swearing like the fisherman that he used to be. He is completely reverted to his old patterns and habits. And Luke adds another wrinkle to make things even more complicated, because just as Peter is completing his third denial with swearing and cursing, showing them, of course, I don't belong to Jesus. Look at me swear. The rooster crows, but not only that, Luke says this, immediately while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Now, I know enough about Jesus to know that Jesus' look was not full of recrimination and accusation, but that eye contact nonetheless must have crushed Peter. Yeah. Right in the middle of him denying Jesus to spare his own skin, Jesus makes eye contact with him. And Peter knows that Jesus knows that he has failed and failed completely. And it's in that moment that the realization of what Peter has just done, the fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy, hits Peter like a lightning bolt. And you can just imagine in that moment, he's been so full of bluff and bluster and denying and cursing and puffing himself up. And you can imagine his ego deflate like a balloon that's been burst, and all of the air goes out of him, and all of the spirit goes out of him, and all of the joy goes out of him, and he collapses in upon himself. And the Bible records that he went out weeping bitterly. He went sobbing into the night. Peter had fallen, and he had fallen hard. He had been exposed as a hypocrite and a loudmouth. He boasted in public and then completely failed when it really mattered. He was no better than any of the other disciples. He had bragged that he alone would stand out from them, but forget being the greatest. That moment he must have thought, I'm the worst, the lowest of the disciples. And in that moment, it's pretty clear from Peter's actions that he no longer knew whether Jesus wanted him as a disciple, if he had any future, if he could be forgiven. I can only imagine the swirl of emotions in his spirit, the loss of appetite in the days to come, the depression, self-loathing, doubts, as if time stood still. And all the color leached out of the world. And all that was left was this deep pain and self-loathing. The embarrassment of public failure has a way of robbing us of so much. Yeah. Sin and failure have a way of stealing every bit of self-worth from us. And as Christians, we're particularly susceptible to this, because even though we recognize that it's God's grace that saves us and it's not by our own merit, so much of our well-being, our self-worth is built upon us being good people and righteous people. And when we sin, it's as if all of that joy is sucked away from us and we feel so low and that we have no value. Our pride, our ego, our sense of self can be utterly destroyed when we publicly fall.
Right.
The embarrassment of that public failure has made a lot of people feel like giving up, or even of committing suicide, because they feel so completely hopeless. I can't come back from this. I can't recover. I can't bounce back. I have nothing left to live for. Jesus knew this moment was coming. And so one of Jesus' clear areas of focus after the resurrection was to work to restore Peter. The angel came and said to those that had come to the tomb, and they gave them the message, reminding them of what Jesus had said, that we have already read that Jesus warned them of how that night they would be scattered like sheep without a shepherd. But he said that when I am risen, he says, you're going to meet me in Galilee, and things are going to turn around. And so the angel comes to reiterate that message. And he said to them, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him, as he said to you. The disciples and Peter. Peter is singled out, and there is both good and bad aspects of that. The good part is that God wanted him to know clearly that he was included. And the bad part is that there's enough damage done to Peter that just the statement, the disciples should go and meet Jesus, is not quite enough for him. Jesus had met privately with Peter, but it's clear that Peter was not quite there yet. So the scene shifts to the north, and we see up in Galilee they had been obedient and gone to where Jesus told them to go, and they are there. But once they are there, Peter decided to go and to try out the old life. And John records in John 21 and 2 that Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We are going with you also." They went out and immediately got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. So we see that 7 of the 11 remaining disciples are together, and Peter decides that he is going fishing. You could read a lot into this, but at very least, there's probably at least some element of Peter checking out the old life to see if he has a plan B, something to fall back on. But even that fails. Peter, the professional fisherman, he goes all night, the most easy time to catch the fish. He goes all night and doesn't even catch one. The Bible says in verse 3 or 4, when morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "Children, have you any food?" They answered him, "No." And he said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." It's like, oh, why don't we think of that? We've only been casting on the left side of the boat. So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and plunged into the sea. So Peter's first step towards his restoration was that he was obedient to the command to go to Galilee. And his second important step is that he shows that he is still desperate to get to Jesus. He's still a little bit impulsive, but it was too long to wait for that boat to get back to shore. And so instead, he dives into the water and begins to swim to Jesus. And in the process, he abandons a massive catch of fish with no thought of them. He has realized in this moment that his joy is not to be found in the net that's being pulled up with over 150 fish in it, but rather his joy is in the one that's waiting on the shore. And he wants to follow Jesus. He wants to be a fisher of men. And so he leaves the catch behind and dives into the sea. Meanwhile, on the shore, Jesus has started to cook breakfast. I don't know where he got his fish, but he's cooking. And they have eaten together, fellowship with Jesus, and now the moment of confrontation comes. Peter's boast of how he would never deny Jesus was public. His denial of Jesus was public. And so Jesus now publicly challenges Peter. The Bible says, as we read in our text, so when they had eaten breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." Then he said to him again a second time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" Yeah. And he said to him, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." This exchange is dependent on the underlying words, because when Jesus asked Peter if you love me, he uses a word that means total commitment.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's asking Peter, "Are you sold out, fully committed to following me? Do you love me more than these fish, than your old life?" And in that moment, all of Peter's doubts come flooding back. The last time he made some kind of bold statement, he ended up falling and failing. Peter's experiencing that rare moment for him of self-doubt, wondering where he stands with Jesus. So Peter's response hedges his bet a little bit. "Yes, Lord, you know that I care deeply for you." But his words fall short of that total commitment.
Yeah.
He's using a different word for love than what Jesus did. Jesus is asking him to be all in, and Peter is saying, I'm mostly there.
Yeah.
So Jesus pushes again and asks again the same question. But once again, Peter responds in the same way. So Jesus pushes a third time, one for each denial. But this time, he subtly changes the language, and he uses Peter's word instead. Essentially, he says, Peter, are you just fond of me? Do you have less than total devotion? John MacArthur says, the third time Jesus asked Peter, he used Peter's word for love that signified something less than total devotion, questioning even that level of love that Peter thought he was safe in claiming. Peter is grieved in his heart. But he's also learned his lesson. He refuses to boast of his commitment. The old Peter would have gone on and said, of course, Lord, I love you more than the whole world. I love you more than any of the other disciples. I love you more than any other human being ever has. Peter knows that that old way has led him to failure. So he refuses to boast of his commitment, and instead he says, Lord, you know all things. You know my heart.
Yes.
You know the truth of how much I love you. And Jesus did. Mm-hmm. Jesus went on to explain to him that things wouldn't always be easy. He even foretold to Peter his own coming martyrdom, that there would be a day that Peter would have to pay the ultimate price and have to back up that commitment in the strongest kind of way. But it was going to take a stand from Peter. But Peter had learned the lesson that commitment is not about what comes out of my mouth, but commitment is about what I do with my life, about the choices I make when my back is up against the wall, the way commit to serve Jesus, even when it's hard, even when it costs me something. And Peter had come to a place to where he didn't need to brag it out, but rather he says, Jesus, you know what's going on in here. You know I love you. But fortunately, Peter's new commitment was both quieter and yet stronger for it. He was ready for his actions to show his commitment and not just his words. He had fallen, but Jesus had picked him back up, and he was now stronger than ever. And when I recollect about Peter, although I'm preaching about these moments here today, this is not what I remember when I think about Peter. When I think about Peter, I think about the man standing on the day of Pentecost, preaching the first Pentecostal message. I think of a man that opens up the door to the Samaritans, and then to the Gentiles. I think of a man that was willing to serve God to the very point to where it cost him his life. He made a stand, and at the end, according to history, when he was confronted with his own crucifixion, he said, my one request is that when you crucify me upside down. I don't deserve to die in the same way that my Lord did. He wasn't begging for his life or saying, don't crucify me, or rather he was just saying, I don't deserve even in this to come close to my Lord. He is so much greater than I. That's the kind of Peter that I think about when I remember him. Our moments of failure don't have to be our defining moments. Peter had failed. Peter had fallen. But Jesus still had a plan for him, a work for him to do. He was still going to give him the keys to the kingdom. He was telling him, even in this, I want you to be a shepherd and a leader, even to your peers. The best was literally yet to come for Peter.
Right.
And they did. I'm speaking to a group of people today as I come towards a close. That just like Peter, you and I are capable of failing. Peter's story is a relatable one, as most of us have been guilty of our mouths writing a check that our actions couldn't cash. It's one thing to fail. It's quite another thing to fail publicly. And often as Christians, our failures are more public. Our lives are more under a microscope than the average person. They are observed more, scrutinized more by ourselves, by our fellow believers, but even unbelievers hold each one of us to a standard that they don't live by themselves. A fail is pretty much guaranteed at some point in our walk with God. So how can we be like Peter rather than Judas and be restored rather than destroyed? Here's the first and most important truth that I want you to take right now and put in your back pocket and keep it close. And that is this: Jesus loves you and Jesus is rooting for your success. I don't care what you have done or how badly you have failed. Jesus desires for you to get back up and for you to be restored. You can take heart and you can be encouraged because if someone you love has fallen, you failed, and you worry for them, know this: Jesus is rooting for their success. He desires them to be restored. Before this ever happened, Jesus made it clear to Peter in Luke 22 and 31. Jesus said, "Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren." Even before he had ever fallen and failed, Jesus was already encouraging him, saying, "I know what's about to come, but I believe in you. I'm praying for your success. And when you return to me," Jesus was confident that Peter was going to get back up and follow after him. And so Jesus' love and support to those who have fallen is going to be a constant.
Yes.
If we will come to him, if we will confess our sin, yes, he will forgive.
Amen.
He will restore.
Yes.
But what do we need to do to make sure that we can be restored? Number one, we have to be obedient. Mm-hmm. Our obedience to God must be greater than our pride. Mm-hmm. How many people have been lost because they refused to go where God sent them to be restored? Jesus says that the restoration would happen in Galilee. And if Peter had put his foot down and said, "No, I'm not going to be restored in Galilee. If Jesus wants me back, he's going to have to come to me in Jerusalem. Or he's going to have to go to Bethany. Or he's going to have to do this." If you start setting terms for God, saying, "God, you've got to do this," you're probably not going to experience that kind of restoration. Because in this moment, it's not about your pride or your ego. It's about being obedient to the one that has the plan of salvation. And so Peter had to make up his mind to return to Galilee, to return to fellowship with his brethren. He was going to have to go right back with the fellas that heard him brag and then denied. But if our desire for restoration is not greater than our pride, we will never be restored. God has made his church the place where restoration takes place. And we have to swallow our pride and go where he wants us to be for restoration to happen. Number two, we have to realize there is no plan B. Peter gave his old life as a fisherman one last go, one last kick at the tires, and he failed. But when Jesus came on the scene and miraculously helped him get what may have been his best catch ever, Jesus wasn't setting him up to fail in his old secular life. Jesus gave him his best, most successful day ever.
Right.
But in that moment, something clicked in Peter's head and he realized, there is no joy for me here in these nets. My joy is standing on that shore. And so he has a net full of fish. But when he realized that it was Jesus that he was there, he dived off the side of the boat and he swam to Jesus. He realized that there was no future for him in his old life. So he literally turned his back on it and dived towards Jesus. Successful restoration is birthed in us when we finally burn the bridges back to our old lives. When we make up our minds, "Jesus, I'm going to serve you no matter what it costs me, no matter what price I have to pay, no matter if it causes me humiliation or grief, I am going to follow you. I'm going to sell out. I'm going to leave no plan B, no escape hatch. Peter did that, there was no turning back, no matter what he faced. And finally, we've got to make a commitment based on our actions rather than our words. When we have fallen, when we are embarrassed, when we're desperate to be forgiven and to be restored, people will make just about any kind of verbal commitment in that moment. They'll agree to ridiculous things that would be impossible for them to do. Well, if I take you back, you're going to have to wash the floors every day, 3 times a day. Of course, honey, I'll do it. Yeah, right. Promises, promises. But success in our restoration is not going to be saying, God, I'm going to be at every service. I'm going to pray in every prayer meeting. I'm going to go to every altar. I'm going to do all these things. But success comes through our actions.
Yeah, exactly.
See, Peter struggled when Jesus challenged him to verbalize his commitment. But I believe in this moment, it wasn't because Peter was now uncommitted. It is because he had finally learned that he had to stop bragging and had to start acting. And his actions from this moment on prove his commitment.
Right.
Peter's life post-restoration is greater by far than his life before his fall. And I want you to have a message of hope today. The music can come back. Why don't you stand with me? My message of hope for you is this. Just as Peter's life was better, greater, after his fall, so too can yours be.
Yes.
See, Satan wants us to think there is no future after a fall. God can't forgive. We can't be restored. We'll never have any credibility once again. We serve a God of reconciliation. And the greatest chapter of our lives is yet to be written. And I want you to know today that there is hope for the fallen. We serve a God that is about restoration. And today I want you to know that your path to restoration, it starts at these altars.
Right.
At a place where we come to God and say, God, you know my shortcomings and you know my failures. Maybe you have to tell them, Lord, to this point, I've served you imperfectly. I've never really fully sold out. I've talked the talk. I've never walked the walk. But Lord, today I'm ready to make that commitment. I'm ready to show you how much I love you, not through my words, but through my actions, through my commitment, through my availability. If that echoes something in your heart, I want to invite you to come to these altars, to come and to seek God right now, and allow God to do a work in your life.